We are still at the chapter one, fundamental. We've been a little bit slow, but don't worry. I think chapter one is going to convey you a lots of idea. Just before I come in here, I said maybe some of you begin to worry that Professor Chen just talk, no mathematics. Actually, some of you probably like no mathematics, lots of physical talk. But that wasn't exactly my intent. Mathematics certainly important because mathematics would convey the very precise information between the engineer and the engineering program. You need a mathematical language to do it. But on the other hand, I think engineer not only need a mathematics, you need a lots of idea to think. And to me, that is more important, more so when you graduate or even now, you can go and buy software commercially available, plug in spherical flow, pipe flow, this flow, that flow, and they can crank out lots of information out for you. But when you get that information, I want you to be able to think. And so in the chapter one, I more want to drill how we think the thermal convection problem. Okay, so that I'm still at it. So again, we derive the equation, we formulate the problem, we have dimensional analysis, you already know how the parameter shows up, and we are on the order of magnitude analysis. And by now, I hope you begin to believe order of magnitude analysis is useful, because it's very simple, give you the algebraic approximation, so give you where the right parameter should be, and even also give you the ballpark figure as to how it is. Just quickly run through, we look at the hydraulics diameter. We're looking at the estimating the flow in the channel. We look at the natural convection, is a baked potato or roast duck at the speed. And then, of course, we are still on that equations. And last time, we talked about a little bit of a boundary layer flow. And the first thing we do is to estimate the boundary layer thickness and the kick-out velocity. And of course, eventually, we want to know how to estimate the friction coefficient. And since it's a flat plate, you don't have a pressure coefficient to worry about the pressure drag. So to do that, again, very quickly, make the all your variable dimensionless, make it change roughly from 0 to 1, so your derivative you can most logically, you can claim this to be above of order one. So from that, we learn boundary layer thickness, and kick out velocity fractions is about the same. So that is 1/√ of Reynolds number. So if a Reynolds number is 10^4, boundary layer thickness is roughly about 1/100, right? So about 1%. 1%, 2%, 3%, I'm not going to argue it's an order of magnitude, right? And the kick-out velocity is about 1% or 3% of your free stream velocity. So you can see the thinner the boundary layer, the larger the boundary Reynolds number, the smaller the kick-out velocity will be. Based on that one, we estimate the friction coefficient by writing the definition there and the expression of a derivative there. We make it dimensionless and do the proper ordering, make it change 0 to 1. So we get it to be of order 1/√ of Reynolds number, which is the friction coefficient. So we know it, the friction coefficient should goes down as the Reynolds number increase. All right? Some of you heard me that I didn't flunk out my PhD exam, but this question I was wrong, so I remember. I was putting on the Phi committee member as a graduate student, and they asked me, "Is there as the Reynolds number goes up, friction coefficient goes up?" And I said, "Gee, Reynolds number goes up, sure, boundary layer becomes thin, the gradient very large." I said, "Yes," and they said, "You fail." Now you see here, the friction Reynolds number goes up. Friction coefficient goes down, right? So now I don't want you to commit to the same mistake I do. I pass out the secret to you. You see, it's, if a Reynolds number goes up, is the absolute skin friction goes up? Answer is yes. I took it as an absolute, but you see here, it's divided by rho u infinity there. So Reynolds number goes up, that the u is going to go up in the square of the velocity. So actually friction coefficient is going down. Friction is going up, but friction coefficient goes down. Okay? So don't make the same mistake as I do if Dr. Crosparty or anyone try to trick you out of it there. All right? So remember that. Now we also know that the relation for lamina flow is 1 over square root Reynolds number. So that's good. As a result of that one, we will be able to get the bounded layer equation out, and we're looking at the relations, which is true. Experiment also bear that one out. Now, the more important to us now is the thermal convections. So we want to estimate the heat transfer in the bounded layer. And as I said, since it's all the mounting analysis, either I have a flat plate or a little bit of attacking angle, as long as it looks like a bounded layer, it is going to behave the same. So we are going to treat it like this. We also know that if you have a temperature difference between the wall and the free stream, you are going to have a heat transfer. And heat transfer is by when you're near the wall, where all the viscous fluid got to come to zero. So the only way to exchange the heat transfer between the fluid and the wall is by molecular thermal conduction. So conduction is coming in, therefore you must have a Prandtl number. Yes?
Is that EF there in the B box supposed to be a CF?
The previous page?
No, it's showing up on the screen right now. It's right just to the left of that figure and below it.
You say EF. You mean this one?
Yeah.
No?
What's this from the previous?
Oh, yes. You are right. This is the friction coefficient. Thank you. I was thinking about the friction layer. We haven't got to that yet. That's a CF. You're right. So please change that one. So we know that Prandtl number right away comes in, because for a fluid without the conductivity, Prandtl number is what? Cp mu over k. If you have said the fluid has no conduction, Prandtl number infinity, you're never looking at that kind of, any kind of fluid, you're looking at the Prandtl number. We already know it for gases, about 1. For water, is about 1 to 10. For oil, couple hundred to 1,000. For liquid metal, about 100. So you see, Prandtl number never goes to infinity, all right? So you cannot say that I have implicit heat convections. There are no such things, okay? Or implicit heat conduction program, right? So you can. So once you have the viscous fluid, Prandtl number is there, and the Prandtl number is going to dictate how the temperature propagate versus velocity propagate. Okay, and we already know Prandtl number is kinematic viscosity over thermal diffusivity. So if you have a very large conducting fluid, thermal diffusivity goes up. Therefore, the temperature layer is going to go very large. Right? Okay, so we want to estimate that. And the last time, again, we did it. Make everything is dimensionless, change 0 to 1. For velocity, we do the velocity way, and for temperature, we do it the temperature way. So you see here, the temperature dimensionless y, we are going to divide by the E times L, E being the fraction of this length represent the temperature boundary thickness, while the delta L, this delta is a fraction of a length represent the velocity thickness. So after we done it, we gone through the order of magnitude argument there. So we end up by saying convections, conductions, and dissipations or friction, right? So if you're looking at the highest derivative in the equation, that got to stay because we know the conduction is there. So this got to stay, and to decide how the boundary layer behave, you can equal this one to convection or equal this one to the frictions. Okay, so we have two possibility, but the convection term has two there, and so we have a two possibility on the convection. So if this dominate, then we got the temperature layer thickness is 1 over square root of Reynolds number, Prandtl number. So right away you know it. If it differ from the velocity for that. Now if you have this part of the convection dominate, then you equate that one, and again, Prandtl number shows up, but without the square root. So at least you know it when the convection and conduction kind of interact each other to decide the convection boundary layer, the Prandtl number should be raised about 0.5 to 1 power. The Reynolds number seems to be always the square root to that. Okay, so now the other case is if the conduction and dissipation equal, that means the layer you are looking at is created by the frictional heating. And that can be different from the convectional heating. So if you equal it, you find the layer, in addition to square root of Reynolds number, square root of Prandtl number, you have a square root of an Eken number. Yeah, okay? So with the three cases there, last time we talked about it, if Eken number is small, and this is small, then of course the first case prevail. So this will be the case, and that will be the length. Therefore, the ratio of velocity layer to the temperature layer will be proportional to the square root of Prandtl number. Right? Actually, if we move it to how, let me go through here quick. The second case, if this is larger than 1, then what you are saying here is small may not be true, so that is greater than 1, all right? And if that is greater than 1, looking at the when this case will become being true, you're looking at this. Assuming this is small, we got this ratio is a Prandtl number. If a Prandtl number is greater than 1, then we contradict ourselves, that being small. So that looks like a case 2 will be mostly variable for large Prandtl number, okay? So if you have that one, then your ratio of this one, that one is proportional to Prandtl number. It's still proportional to Prandtl number, but it's just power change. Okay, if we go to the third case, which is the friction now dominate, then of course, Eken number has to be very large to become significant. And that translates, this has to be that bigger than that, this got to be greater than Prandtl number, then your friction layer is going to look like this. And now you can see the velocity boundary layer and the friction layer is going to go by this, not only the Prandtl. So the larger the Eken number, the larger the ratio is going to be. Yes? You see, if Eken number is not greater than this, you're looking at this case here. You know here, right? Eken number is here. Let me see. Where am I? Okay, here. Eken number is here times this is order 1, right? Now, if Eken number is smaller than this, then it's not significant, yeah. But then you know it, this and that must be, if for this to be significant, must be Prandtl number. Because we know the ratio of this one is a Prandtl number. You remember we look at this case?
Well, the ratio of those two, though, changed for all those cases.
Yeah, if Eken number is small, if a Prandtl number is large, Eken number is smaller than this, then it will not be of significance, right? So that is why I say or. I'm translating this. Or maybe you, if you like, you can put the Prandtl number to some power, okay? the other two cases is either square root of Prandtl number or the Prandtl number. But the Prandtl number is small, then I know it's less than 1. But the first one I already require Eka number must be greater than 1. Okay, so I'm sort of like a Eka number compare with the two convection term. I want to make sure Eka number is large enough to be of any significance for us to really look into. Okay, so now last time we talked about it, if Eka number is of no significance, then our heat transfer will be standard like this. If wall temperature is large, this is small, then the heat conduction, or the vice versa. If outside temperature is large, wall temperature is small, then you know heat flux is going which direction. So in that case, you can define the heat transfer as we've been doing before. The Newton's cooling law will be Q equal H, the temperature difference there. Okay, and then, of course, at the wall, no fluid motion there, so it will be only by conduction, so that's equal to that. So if you clean this one up, normalize it, you get the Nusselt number, which is this over that. All right? Now again, make this dimensionless in a proper way. That means make it to be of order 1. We can do this and bring the extra E here. So the Nusselt number is order 1 over E. And if you plug in what the E's expression is for non-frictions, the friction is not important. Less than Prandtl number 1 looks like this. Greater than Prandtl 1 looks like that one. Or if you like to say, looks to me Nusselt number must be of order 1 times square root of Reynolds number and to some power to the Prandtl number, maybe 0.5 and 1. All right? And if you're looking at the example, or actually the homework, I ask you to go and search it. But we can take a look now. I cited a couple examples here. First example is a flow over boundary layer. You can see the Prandtl number. This is actual experiment and also theoretical result through the Prandtl boundary layer equation. 0.33, Reynolds number 1/2, Prandtl number to the 1/3. You see our order magnitude show that this is order 1, 0.3 is like order 1. Right, and Reynolds number to the half is precise. Prandtl number to the 1/3 is very close to about 1/2 we got. All right. Now looking at the second example, the flow past the cylinder, which looks like this. You can see the Nusselt number is 0.6. Reynolds number is 0.466. Not quite 5, 0.5. For what reason? It's involving a little bit of separation behind there. This is the average Nusselt number. Looking at the next one, the flow past a bundle of a tube, which is very important in the boiler design, you know, all the flow going. You see, the Nusselt number is 0.33, Reynolds number 0.6, Prandtl number 1/3. You see, very close to what we estimate. One more, cone, flow past a cone. You look at it, Nusselt number is 0.5, Reynolds number 0.5, Prandtl number 1/3. Why is the 0.5 that clear? Because flow past a cone is mostly boundary layer-like, all right? So for that one, I assigned a homework, let you go and dig out your own, be it a book or handbook or monograph or the paper, let you go and search it to see if you can verify for yourself, to convince yourself, hey, laminar boundary layer flow is like a 0.5, okay? Now, back to the where we have a frictions. When you get a frictions, now, it is not as easy because as you see here, I cited two examples that the temperature TWT infinity here, well, depending on how you interpret this drawing that my TA did it, suppose the TW and T infinity are even the same. You see, the frictional heating is going to bring the temperature higher, then not because the fluid and the wall temperature is the same, you have no heat transfer. Because the fluid is going to generate the heat, it will go both ways. Okay? Or you can look at the case, the surrounding fluid is lower than the wall temperature, but now all of a sudden you think the wall got to give out some energy out, it is not. Yes?
In this case, how can we give the technician?
Temperature boundary layer again, this as a friction layer cooling down here, and the temperature reached 99%. Well, actually now, if it's higher, you may want to say, if outside is 100%, you may say 101%. then you call your convection layer. That means near the boundary, the temperature is influenced through the near the boundary. Okay, so for example, if you are 100 degrees, this may be 200 degrees. So if you are 101, it's reaching almost like a within 1% of your free stream velocity. You see, like a boundary, we define 99%. It's within 1% of a free stream velocity, right? But then if you define this way, you get it from the convection equal conduction, right? But you say, well, how important is my friction layer? Then you equal the conduction over the friction is what you are going to get, and therefore, this is what they are going to give you. You see, the temperature layer will be defined like this. Friction layer, you have an additional Eckert number there. EF is, again, is a kind of mental layer thickness of the friction. For example, I draw it over here. You see? All the way out here is a convection layer, convection bound layer. This layer, you said the friction is going to generate heat, and you may want to call that as friction layer. No, it just give you a roughly how important the friction is. You may want to say that the frictional inference up to here, maybe about 90% of the frictional heat. Well, the frictional heating after this layer is not going to be important. So you got to decide is 1% or 5% or 10% there. You see, this is all the order magnitude we are talking about, right? Yes?
Same page, actually, there's something right above those three figures. It says if Eckert number is greater than 1 and Eckert number is greater than the Prandtl number, then case 3 can be written. Is that correct?
If Eckert number is greater than 1, Eckert number is greater than Prandtl number, then case can be written. I got to think about that.
Well, in the example you do below that, I mean, they vary by the square root of the Eckert number. And the Eckert number is supposed to be large, so.
Yeah, that statement, I forget why I said that. I was just going to say there may be a case that the friction bound layer and the convective bound layer will be just as big. That may not, okay, let me think about that.
The problem, the thing that if you look at that example, they vary by 1/1 square root of Eckert number, and the Eckert number is supposed to be large for these problems.
Yeah. If I say that if an Eckert number is 1, then the convection layer and the friction layer is the same. Because you can look.
If the number is 1, generally, you're not going to have to worry about
that. That's right. Well, Eckert number is 1 is about the same level. If an Eckert number is 1, this term is there. This is there. All right. So actually, I probably should say that if Eckert number, yeah, probably just a mistypo. Maybe Eckert number is 1, Eckert number is equal to Prandtl number, then that is equal. Right? Yeah, which, I'm sorry. This should not be greater. I think maybe my original note probably is equal. That's why when you ask me, I kind of puzzle myself. If an Eckert number is 1, Prandtl number is also 1, then they are equal. Right.
So does that need to be the case for the equation right above what we're talking about? Under 4K3 be dominant? Eckert number, you say Eckert number has to be greater than 1 for case.
Yeah, right. For case 3 to be dominant, that means it's very pronounced that you can see like this, right? But if it happened to be Eigen number is one, Planck number one, then you see there all the friction is kind of merged into the whole layer. There you kind of see the distinction there. Okay, so now last time I talked about it, because of this funny situation on the friction heating is going to throw you are thinking of. So we have to redefine our convective heat transfer Newton's cooling law. Because the cooling law normally say that, well, it's a proportional to the temperature difference between the fluid and wall. But that now is not true anymore because you don't know. So the first thing you do, you got to revise. And most of the formula now used for the aerodynamic high-speed heat transfer, particularly Dr. Yuru probably would like to see that, is instead of T infinity, because the outside fluid now don't dictate how the heat flow. So we are going to using a T adiabatic. Now we got to define what is T adiabatic. Wall temperature certainly is there. It's very close. So but then that is still the temperature gradient is there. So what is the T adiabatic? Last time I talked about it, remember I slumped my hand so many times on there. It's if it is a stagnation temperature, so now you can looking at I say, what is the T adiabatic? T adiabatic, let's review it. In your gas dynamics, it's an inviscid fluid. The stagnation enthalpy is your flow enthalpy plus the kinetic energy, right? You know it. So if we divide the C sub P there, so T stagnation is T infinity plus that. Okay? And that is all come from inviscid theory. You remember all your gas dynamics is just inviscid there. Now the T adiabatic is defined this way. T adiabatic is T infinity. This one, almost the same expression, except you have alpha there. Now you said, how come is this way? It says, of course, there's if you go to the compressible high-speed boundary layer, you analyze it, you calculate so many different Prandtl number, put the wall in the insulation, you figure out what is the wall temperature, which we call now adiabatic, is going to be, it is going to look like this. Now, if you study a little bit more, for the laminar boundary layer, this alpha is equal, approximately equal to square root of Prandtl number. So you see, if a Prandtl number is a 1, looks like T adiabatic is like a T stagnation. The Prandtl number is 1 means what? The viscous propagation and temperature propagation go at the same speed. So you will not lose it. That how much you propagate in speed, the temperature just follow it. Right? And if a Prandtl number is not equal to 1, then you should expect the T adiabatic will not be the same. So what is a T adiabatic? Last time I explained it, it's a setup case for your reference. That means you may solve an actual problem with the wind section, can have a heat transfer go both ways. But you say, suppose the same problem except my surface now is insulated. And what will be my temperature under all the frictional heating, everything is going on. So it looks like this. The T adiabatic is a setup case for your proton, which the surface is insulated. And you go and calculate what kind of temperature you are going to get at the surface. Of course, when we say adiabatic or insulated one, the temperature gradient there got to be 0. All right? Otherwise, we will have a heat transfer. So once you find this one out, then you know which direction of a heat is going to flow. If a T wall in your actual problem is greater than T adiabatic, then you know it. Even have a friction, the wall is going to give out energy to the fluid. If a T wall in your actual case is smaller than T adiabatic, then you know you are going to receive the heat transfer. So if you are aeronautical engineer going hired by McDonnell or the Boeing and so forth, or the North American Aviation, looking at the solving the X-wing and all of those, then you got to calculate under the certain condition, first, insulate your wind section, find out the temperature. Then you give it actual temperature, you are flying, whatever the measurement is, then you know which direction the heat is going to go. All right? So the modified Nusselt number for the frictional heating is going to using a T adiabatic, and then you clean them out, then you have looks something like that. All right. So it's not as easy like regular convection problem, because you know the outside fluid temperature, you know the wall temperature. In the frictional heating case, you have one more work to do, find out the T adiabatic. All right? OK. We've gone through this example. You can look at the one more example here. Without the frictional heating, I cited the flow near the stagnation point, which is the kind of blunt side of it here. You can see it's order 1. We figure out the square root of Reynolds number. The experiment show us 1.14, which actually make you happy, because I'm so crude in order magnitude estimate, but I'm coming so close to it. And you see the Prandtl number now raised to 0.4. It's even closer to what we estimate. All right? Now, if you go to the spherical shape here, you see the Nusselt number now is 1.32, Reynolds number this one, that. OK? So I hope with this example, I convince you, say, what I'm talking on the boundary layer growth, the Nusselt number is proportional to Reynolds number of 0.5. It's no fluke. It's actually, indeed, there's an explanation there. And somehow, no heat transfer book picked this one up to tell all of us, as an engineer or as a student, say, hey, look, here's a 0.5 is for the reason which is a boundary layer, right? But if you look at it this way, it looks like a very convincing. It's related to the boundary layer. OK, now with all of this done, I'm beginning to wrap up what the order magnitude is, except let's clean them up by plugging all those estimates we got and drop all the small term in the boundary layer-like equation. Then all of a sudden, you find, hey, you got the Prandtl boundary layer approximation. Continue the equation. Prandtl said this is true. That, actually, we already integrated that one into dp dx. And in the temperature, you can see here, two convection term there with the Prandtl number. Now, why the Prandtl number show up here? I'm using the same y as it's defined in the velocity layer, OK? Because now you know it's a delta here, delta 1 over square root. So I define the y is y over l times the square root of Reynolds number. Then you can see the Reynolds number don't appear in my boundary equation. You get absorbed, OK? And if I continue to use the same variable, then the Prandtl number will show up here. OK, and the Eken number, of course, is there. That's fine. So this is what we know now is an incompressible boundary layer equation or boundary layer approximation. OK? All right. Any question on the external flow estimate this way? OK, if not, let's turn to the internal flow estimate. I gave you a picture of this in here. What does this strike you? Looks like an entrance flow, right? The you're looking at the channel or the tube here. Actually, those white mark is a so-called timeline. It's a hydrogen bubble. If I have a channel here, how many of you actually see the hydrogen bubble experiment? OK, let me describe a little bit here. If I have a channel here, and which is the water, OK, you mix a little bit of something salt, so it will ionize a little bit. So you put a wire, a platinum wire. It can take a little bit higher temperature platinum wire. For water, you probably need about DC volt, about 50 volt or higher. You pass the current on it with a 50 volt there. Then the wire is going to disintegrate your water into hydrogen and oxygen, right? So that become a bubble. A hydrogen bubble is, can show up. And now once you pass the line there, you cut it off. So it's sort of like a, you energize it, you take it off, and the hydrogen bubble shows up. And 1 second, right? So after certain time, maybe say 2 seconds or 5 seconds later, this is going to move over here, and then you give it one more time. So you give it on the periodic base. If this is every second, you boom, 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 and then the line is going to develop. Okay?
It stops the hydrogen bubbles from rising to the surface of the water. And
yes.
Because they're so much lighter than the water.
Right. But hydrogen bubble is going to be so tiny.
Okay.
So it'll remain, yes, yes, right, right, yeah. So you can see it, this is sort of like a timeline. So if this is every 1 second, then I can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 seconds. So this is what the 10 seconds later, this fluid move all the way here, give you this. Now what we are looking at this, obviously, we are looking at the so-called developing flow. You see the flow coming here flat, rectangular profile. But then after you're going through here, you begin to see this not much change anymore. So that we call it the developed flow. So in the internal flow, we're always looking at some section called developing flow or entrance region. Okay. And then you see at some section is already developed. Okay? So now the questions, again, we are still on order of magnitude. If I say Mr. Lin or Schoff, go and estimate, giving you a channel with viscosity, density, and the inlet velocity, tell me how long would it take for this profile to look like all developed. Don't tell me need a 2-year project. I don't want it, right? So again, we are going to make some estimate here. And this, again, is the same thing. They have a different hydro wire set up in the different location channel, and they just energize it every so second. So this is a multiple flow here. So you can see here. The top one is done at 1.6 Reynolds number 10 to the third, so like a 1,600. The bottom one is about half of that one, Reynolds number 640. Okay, this I get it from Japan Society of Flow Visualization. They have a handbook on the flow visualization. I got it out, so I thought we'll give you so that I can convince you my drawing is somewhere close to what you just see on the actual experiment there. So here is our order of magnitude estimate of entrance region, okay? Again, we want to do it in very quick, maybe about in 15 minutes. We like to estimate what kind of relation is there. Is the entrance region goes inverse proportional to Reynolds number or proportional to Reynolds number? If it is a proportional, is this a square root or it is what? All right? So we want to quickly estimate that. So now I draw the boundary layer because this is a flat profile comes in here. And if any outside velocity remain very much like that one, I can pretend it is a boundary layer. Okay? Maybe a good time to take a break. They want us to take a break. Very interesting, and make you think. If your friend asks you, okay, all right. I'm still going to say it anyway. It's in the tape. If your friend say, you are a fluid dynamicist, right? And so you must know something about fluid, and you are going to say yes. But his question is that the sky is going to rain. Not like My Fair Lady, I don't know, the American student probably know. Rain in the Spain is plainly, it's going to rain, right? It's going to rain, but then they ask, isn't that if I drop a baseball, it is going to accelerate, right? It will keep accelerating. If a rain is going to fall from such a high, let's say 5 kilometer high, why the raindrop would not drop on the earth at a very high speed like a bullet, and anyone walk out on the street would get killed? when it's rain, right? Tell me why. And subsequent to my question is that if there is a terminal velocity there, rain, obviously, you like it when you are hot. Go under the rain, it cools you off. You feel very comfortable, right? What is the rain velocity hitting you? Can you estimate that? All our magnitude analysis. You are going to get it next time. Let you go and estimate why the rain will not continue to accelerate. If there is something to it, estimate the terminal velocity of a rain. Very realistic, very popular science-like questions, but it's challenging. So begin to think about it the next time you are going to get it. All right? Okay, now we're back to our estimate here. So we are going to estimate this, and with the inlet velocity being flat, and eventually become sort of like a parabolic. Now, if I begin to say, here is a layer like this, Lin is going to challenge me, how you define that layer? Or I'm going to say, I'm going to change a little bit here, because you see, obviously, I draw a larger velocity here than this. And many of you know, took the intermediate fluid, you know it, the center line velocity is going to go a bit faster. Actually, it can be quite faster, 1.5. Accelerate in there, the channel flow. Because the fluid don't pass here, they got to go and get squeezed into the center. But the line I'm drawing is roughly that where the center portion velocity stay fairly flat. Okay. So I'm drawing it as if like a two bundle layer is growing into one. And I think many instructors probably will tell you, hey, entrance flow, you can see you start with a viscous effect on the wall, so it is going to propagate up, so the two boundary layer is going to merge, and so we can define approximately when the two boundary layer merge, that is a point of ending the entrance region. Because once it's merged, you are going to see probably about the same velocity profile from that point on, approximately, right? So now, let's estimate that. Now, that is only fluid. We are in the thermal convection, so we got to go and estimate. If I have a temperature comes in, which is different from the wall temperature here, I'm going to ask when the temperature profile is going to merge together. If you think a little bit more carefully, you say Professor Chen is in trouble because temperature profile will never develop. Because even the two temperature profile merge each other, would temperature profile continue to change downstream? Suppose the wall temperature, the way I draw it, the wall temperature is higher than the inlet temperature, right? So if I have here, as long as I have a temperature gradient here, the energy is going to continue to go into the fluid, even though I pass the entrance region where the two temperature boundary layer like merge together, it is continual. Eventually, what is going to happen? All fluid is going to be the same as the wall temperature, right? So you know it. So I got to define my temperature entrance region a little bit different. It just say two boundary layer like one merge there, and I'm just going to stop that. Okay, that is where we are going to call thermal entrance region. Okay. Okay, so now let's go and ask ourselves, what is this L, which is this length? What is this L? I'm using a subscript E there is an energy, right? Just like I'm using for the E in the. So the two lengths, one is not necessarily the same, just like we already know it, the Prandtl number is going to make a difference, all right? So let's go and estimate how long would it take for a velocity profile to become fully developed. So we are going to borrow it. After all, it's all the mounting analysis. Why don't we borrow it? Boundary layer concept. We already know it. Boundary layer is growing. The Y thickness here is delta L, and L is here. Delta, in the boundary layer definitions, the Reynolds number is what? U infinity L over nu, right? That is the way we define in the external flow. Its length is along where you are flowing. However, internal flow, this long, there is no definite length here. So the Reynolds number normally is defined by the diameter. So it's ud, and u being an inlet velocity, right? So that over that. So you got to make sure that you are talking about the same apple or the same oranges, right? So so if a y thickness is defined this way, and the temperature thickness is defined this way, okay? So now what can we use? Well, if this is boundary layer, can I borrow it to define this is my boundary layer? So this will be. So when I have a two boundary layer merge, that means my boundary layer thickness has to grow to one half of the channel width. Because each layer is growing, right? So I just make it one half should be the right ballpark. So that is what I'm going to do. I'm going to make a boundary layer is growing at d over half, which is this location about here where it's merged. Okay, so now you may want to ask me what you are doing here. I say, well, what I want to do is a boundary layer grow to half of the channel, then I know the two boundary layer merge. And I'm going to estimate that L. That L is going to give me the entrance region, right? So let's do that. So now I'm changing this is that is L over this, because we know it. This, remember, we look at here, after subtract, this L over this, right? So now, except I change the velocity to inlet velocity as infinity. But I got to be very careful, because my Reynolds number definition for the internal flow is using a d here. So I got to time the d, divide by the d, move the L over here. So now this is what I got, right? So let me reshuffle it, factor everything L over d on this side, and all the Reynolds number according to definition is this. So what I find is the length of a developing flow, the entrance region divided by L, is 1/4 Reynolds number over this order 1 to the square. Why I want to carry the order 1 square? If it's a 1 square, doesn't matter. If it is 2, I quickly get a 4 out of it, right? So you can see from the experiment, looking at the experiment in the channel flow, for laminar flow, the entrance length over the diameter is Reynolds number divided by 20. That's an experiment show about that. You see how my order magnitude estimate looks like? If I get a 2 here, which is order 1, 2, you won't argue with me. I got a 4 here, 4, 4 is 16. It's very, very close. Not only that, I got the right expressions. The length over the diameter is proportional to Reynolds number, which the experiment show that is true. All right? So you can see all the magnitude, we only spend about 10 minutes to clean them up. We don't need a 2 year of programming and all of this debugging of your numerical to realize the entrance region is proportional to Reynolds number. Okay? Now we can do the same thing for the temperature layer. Now the temperature layer must be one half that one, and the temperature layer as we define it here is going to have a Prandtl number there, which is for like a Prandtl number less than 1, maybe like a air, maybe to some stretch a little bit like a water. So you can see the entrance length here after you juggling around is going to show me the thermal entrance region is 1/4 Reynolds number times the Prandtl number. Okay? And from the experiment, it shows that. See, so the proportionality of Prandtl number is also right with the experiment. So to give an example there, if a Reynolds number 1,000 in channel flow, you know it's going to be laminar flow, then the entrance length is about 50 diameter. So if you have 1 inch here, and the Reynolds number 1,000 comes in here, take maybe about here, 50 of that one to become developed. So that to give you a rough idea. I remember at the Iowa one time I got a from a GM, somebody called me and said, we are designing an experiment try to get into a fully developed flow part of the experiment, they asked me on the phone, how long do we need to set up from the entrance on till we get it? They want to cut down the length there. So I quickly did, oh, wait a minute, look at my note. And I said, OK, you are Reynolds number time this one. And the minimum length is that. And beyond that one, you probably can treat as the fully developed. OK, so that way you can quickly think that way. OK, if a Prandtl number is 0.7, then your summer entrance region will be much shorter. Oh. 35. Just a mistypo. Yeah. Okay. Now we have done the external flow. We have done the internal flow. We are going to do one unsteady flow. And then I will say the order of magnitude, the illustration is done. Okay, here you already see that picture. Suppose I take this plate. In the air here. My hand is not as steady horizontally, but I'm just shaking like this. You see, I have a velocity amplitude, right? I can go like that, or I can go like that, right? The amplitude here. And the I have a frequency. So that the two, amplitude and the frequency, I can go like this, right? Now, if I walk in at this one, if I ask, is the air here is still stagnant, or air here is stagnant, or here air is stagnant? So we've been asked how this plate motion is going to affect how large the layer here. That's important, right? That means the penetration of this motion into the air. OK? So we are going to estimate that. They are getting noisy. OK. So the plate is going to move. Maybe go and close this one. We are about to done now, so we can bear a little bit. OK, so suppose we put the velocity at the wall into this is the magnitude, the amplitude, put through the cosine omega t motion. So you know velocity will be positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, like that one in the harmonic motion like this. So you can see when you move here, velocity is going to get dragged this, but the previous motion on this side, the fluid just barely catch up, so it's still on the negative side, so your profile is going to look like this. But then when you put it back here, it is still fluid, it's still moving over here, go here. If you continue to move here, the fluid barely back. So they are always phase lag. You put it here, they are just moving on this side. When you pull it back, they are just about move this side, you go down. Okay, so the penetration length will be something like that, okay? Now, I'm going to take a little bit quicker cut here. If this plate is an infinity length, right? So right away, you said, if it is infinity, whole thing is moving like this. This doesn't matter. I set up my origin here, x0, or my x0 here, or x0 here. That means it doesn't matter where x is. So it's independent of x, right? So you can see independent of x. Now, if a plate is moving horizontally, there will be no w component or the y component. All moving is just this way. Okay? So we set uvw equals 0. And if it is in the infinity fluid, no pressure gradient. So at least that much we know. So using that one, we clean up our Navier-Stokes equation. It's left u with this. Right? And then we want to estimate the penetration length. Actually, this already tells you that the viscous force is going to control how far you can penetrate, obviously so. Because if there's no viscosity there, no matter how you shake it, air is not going to move. So viscous force here, and obviously it's unsteady term there. So that, so all we have to do is make this dimensionless, make this dimensionless, change from 0 to 1, see what we get in the length, because we got to use the length, this L, as our y scale, all right? So let's do it here. U divided by u infinity, you know it, 0 to 1 at the far away. Y at the wall is 0, at the length 1, which is 1, okay? So then what then is L? So we put plug in there. We know it's unsteady phenomenon, it's a viscous phenomenon, so we can claim this is 1, this is 1, we get that. So what is L? L is square root of kinematic viscosity divided by frequency. You say where the frequency come from, I forgot to mention the time, we can use it as omega t, right? So because it's a frequency in there. So you can see, you go and looking at the, any one of you recognize what is this program? There's a name. If Professor Cross Parry ask, give me the Stokes problem one, what is that? Yeah, Kowalski?
I don't know, it's just Stokes problem.
Stokes problem one or Rady problem? Because Rady and Stokes independent solve the same problem. Stokes problem one or the Rady problem is time equals zero when the fluid is not in motion. Time greater than zero, all of a sudden the plate set into a constant motion. Okay, continuous constant motion. That is the first problem. The Stokes second problem is this. Stokes say that the time greater than zero, no, it's a periodically, I'm just, so this is the Stokes second problem. And why is this? Because this has the exact solution available. That's why have some name in there, all right? Okay, so you can see, you can estimate, you can go and dig out the Stokes second problem, look at his paper, and you see the penetration length. Actually, even you're looking at analytic solutions, you may not realize the penetration length is such, unless you ask yourself how far it's going to penetrate. But using all the magnitude, if we ask a question pointed, we want the penetration length, you can quickly estimate in this way. Okay? So I said that, all right, I'm not going to say a whole lot more on the order amount you estimate, except I gave you one of my paper I published in 1978, so almost quite a long time ago. I will just let you go and read it, but let me kind of entertain you how I get this problem. And what I did with it. You see, my doctor thesis is a rocket reentry to the Earth. And the rocket reentry to the Earth with a supersonic speed that have a shock wave. Behind the shock wave, temperature is very high. So the rocket nose is going to melt. So my thesis is to do an experiment, simulated experiment and theoretical analysis of how much the melting is going on so that by the rocket return to the Earth, the inside part is not damaged, like a heat seal on the shuttle flight and so forth. So, but in the 60s, when I did the thesis, they are thinking the coat of the rocket nose and those fly, the Mercury fly, the Gemini fly, by some silica, like a glass-like thing, because they think it's a good insulator. As it turned out, you remember, maybe some of you are too young, the Scott Carpenter had the Mercury flight, and when he came down, the trajectory is way off 300 miles. So you see the Navy ship got the chase where that rocket comes down. They normally expect it to be coming within 1 or 2 miles. They are waiting there. All of a sudden, they couldn't find where the Scott Carpenter is. It's off about 300 miles. Is either they miscalculated or they miscalculated the entry drug. You see, that's coming there, shockwave, and that the silica is going to melt. And if it is male, it's a surface feature change, drag force change. And all of a sudden, instead of coming down here, they're going to come way down over there. So they got a probe, and so that was a NASA project I got to work on it, try to find out why the melting surface is so rough. So I did that on my thesis, and then I continue to be interested in that one. And one day, I got a call from Jet Propulsion Laboratory. He said, hey, we know you are doing this stuff. Now we are going to go to where? This probe, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory is going to shoot an interplanetary rocket to where? To Jupiter. And Jupiter's atmosphere is all hydrogen. Okay? It's all hydrogen. So they would like to have this probe, which looks like this shape, is going to enter the Jupiter with a very high velocity, like a Mach 5. And so they told me the temperature the entry velocity, the temperature will be 10,000 Kelvin after the shock wave, all right? The velocity will be 2 × 10⁶ centimeter, but 2 × 10⁴ meter per second, all right? And all of this, and they figure out it cannot using a male, so they got using graphite. And the special kind of graphite they call CN, okay? It's the kind of a combined the graphite there. So they asked me that, and I asked them, why don't you do an experiment? He said, Jupiter atmosphere is a hydrogen. If we have a hydrogen wind tunnel, a light of a match, the whole thing is going to explode. We cannot do the experiment. We got to have some theoretical model to go and figure it out. And I said, you so trust the theoretical model without the experiment? They said, yes, we do have an experiment. We have a shock tube, you know, have a shock tube with all hydrogen there, and have a diaphragm there, and have a tiny probe in there, just boom, have a shock wave of a 5, goes in Mach 5. So figure out how much melting, but this is too small. We want to have some other verification to see if you can do something for us. So I got a project for about a year to do this. So I told them that no promise of accuracy, because there's no way in 1 year I'll be able to do all this analysis. You see, here, with this probe here, this is the carbon, okay? The special graphite carbon there. It is going, they tell me, if the temperature is so hot, the carbon is not going to melt, but instead it's going to sublime, okay? It just evaporate with that temperature. And they said, is that the evaporation velocity is enough to seal off the temperature? You know, evaporate quick enough so the temperature will not come in because the temperature is so high. Otherwise, it destroy all their probe. And I said, gee, you're asking too much. I don't even know how to think about the radiation or everything there. I said, well, I'll do my best. So I said, I'm going to do all the magnetic analysis, just tell you roughly what it's like. And they gave me one data point. Okay, one experimental data, one experimental data point, which is is the shock tube data point, is there. Okay, and they said figure out some other relation. So since the time is getting close, I'll just quickly say that I did all the magnetic analysis, and you see it's very messy because all our class talk is incompressible. Everything is nice, laminar flow. And I analyze it. Now I have two fluid. One is a hydrogen layer, okay? So now you can see how many layers I got to go through. I have a shock, then have a flow toward the body, which is not a boundary layer. Then I have a hydrogen boundary layer, all right? I call it the hydrogen in this layer, then the hydrogen boundary layer. Then I have a sublime, and the sublime is so hot, the fluid is just spewed out from the body. And then when this sublimed CN gas meet the hydrogen, they got a turn. So then I got a CN bonded layer there. So I say, OK, everything I can do, I just pretend this is the layer, that is there, that is there. And I go and do all the Mandrian analysis or doing this. And you see, it's very messy. But then I said, to comfort myself, I said, I'm going to perform a little bit of experiment. And they said, well, what kind of experiment are you going to do? I said, dry ice in the wind tunnel. You see, the dry ice, if I blow a hot air on it, dry ice sublime, it would not melt. So you see, I did an experiment. This is not on your, this is the beginning of the dry ice. After so many seconds of the sublimations in the wind tunnel, I get this shape. So I verify the surface is not going to be rough, all right? And of course, you are going to ask me that, how do you know the dry ice is like the graphite model in the hydrogen? I said, well, I have a parameter. You see, once you do the dimensional analysis and all the magnitude analysis, I come up with all the parameter. I tell them that my dry ice model under this setup is somewhere close to what they are doing. So I did all the magnitude analysis. I did the parameter analysis, tell them that my experiment looks like be OK. And so finally, I use my order magnitude analysis and analyze the condition they gave me. My order magnitude analysis come out about there. good or bad, it's up to you to say it. But I say, well, I did some analysis. Here is the theory. If you have a different condition, go ahead and use it. So I ask JPL, do I have a permission to publish this? Is this national confidential? They say, well, you can publish it. So I just wrote it up, and it's in the AIAA journal. Yeah. So I'm not going to go through that detail. It's too specialized, but I give you an example. The order magnitude analysis can go very, very far. You're looking at some very complicated phenomena. Yes?
A question, just for curiosity. What happened with the real rocket? Did they fly? One or no?
I don't think they finally built the this one to go to Jupiter.
I see.
Yeah. Now the Jupiter is a flyby there. You know, go to the like Mars or the Moon, they have a crash running. Just they want to sacrifice the instrument anyway. They just let the gravity of the Mars just pull it in. But before it hit it, they already signal back all the data they get. But now they begin to think that's too expensive. So now they want to, they call Grand Tour, you know it, go to there and swing around using the gravity of the planet, swing out to another planet and another one. I think one of the probe is out of the universe now. It never returned. And I think one of the probes, they lost the battery or something. They didn't send the signal back. But I should close the class now. But just quickly comment, in this country, the space explorations has two standoff school. One school say that the unmanned probe, that means don't have an astronaut get in there and go and see it. So they are lobbying for the Congress, President, NASA to build an unmanned probe. Go just send it there. The other school said that the men got to be in there, be it be Mars or Jupiter or anywhere, then we got to go and see it. And the men in there is a men's achievement. So they are all always fighting in the federal budget. One is a men probe, one is a men to the probe. You can take side whichever. I'm not going to take side with that. All right, I'll stop here.